Hey guys, thank you for joining us at our live broadcast a few weeks back. It was tons of fun and we had some really good questions, so Andy and I are going to take 10 minutes to go through them.
Excellent, let's do it.
This is from Kathleen, and she's asking...
Hi Kathleen.
Hey Kathleen, what colors are on your palette?
Okay, the basic colors on my palette, and again, it really depends on the subject and what I'm working on. This is a great question, Kathleen, and thank you for asking it. I usually start with the limited palette. That might be something you might have heard us talk about in the past or something you may have heard before, where we, you know, ultimately it's, Kremen's white or lead white, yellow ochre, vermilion, and ivory black. But my palette has expanded over the years, and I also use colors like alizarin crimson, ultramarine, cobalt blue, yellow ochre, Naples yellow, red iron oxide. So these are a number of colors that I complement the palette with and add to it depending on the subject and the problem that I'm confronting.
Oh, okay, next one is from Anne-Marie, and she's asking...
Hi, Anne-Marie.
Hey there. She's asking, how do you work out what background color to use?
Boy, that's a great question, Anne-Marie. And again, it really depends on the subject. You know, I tend to like to paint a more neutral background that allows the colors on the model... You know, I'm doing more portraiture, so I want the background to, if you will, to complement or support the subject that I'm painting or drawing. Now, this is not a hard, fast rule. Some of the most beautiful paintings have backgrounds that are with colors that are the complete opposite of what I'm describing. But when I look back at the old masters, when I look back at Rembrandt or Velázquez in their portraiture, or Sargent, for an example, the backgrounds are usually pretty neutral or subdued that allows the actual model or the subject to be able to be the main focus. And so that's what I tend to look for. But again, you know, I think it's really important to experiment in all different kinds of backgrounds, from a simple sheet to something that has patterns and is complicated, whatever interests you. That's what's really important. I think in the end, you should only do a painting that inspires you, and to work with objects that are inspiring to work from. So, you know, if you feel a pull to work a specific way, I say go for that. That's the best answer.
Yeah, I mean, it's really interesting. Even like take color aside, just how much like impact value has in a background.
Oh, absolutely. And the background is very important, you know, and something that often gets neglected. One of my friends who's a phenomenal painter, Joachim Eriksson, the guy's awesome. He's one of my teachers. Joachim, I love you, man. He told me one time he was having a painting shown and somebody came up to him and said, boy, I really love your background. And you know, some people might get offended by that, but not Joachim, because he understands how complicated a background is and its role in making the subject pop. And he was just so grateful, so thankful for that compliment. I tell you, anybody that gets a compliment on the background, that's a good thing, you know? So something to think about.
Nice, nice. Well, okay, and then for the last question.
Sure.
It is a really good one. What are some books you would recommend for learning figure and portrait work?
Oh my God, that's a great one. And it's a huge one.
Yeah.
Well, I think some of the books I think that are really great to start off with is the Harold Speed book. You know, the Harold Speed Practice and Science of Drawing. And I forgot the title of his painting book, but you find the Practice and Science of Drawing, mm-hmm. you'll find his painting book. And I think these are really good books to get you started on the tradition of the tradition that we're coming from,
yeah.
but also are just really good informative books on building a method and good habits. That's ultimately, I think, what you want to be looking for. You know,
what do you think of Loomis?
Oh yeah. Well, the Loomis books are great. You know,
yeah.
in my old art school, we used to call him Saint Loomis. You know, Yeah, all the Loomis books, especially if you want to get into drawing and just learning construction, you know, oftentimes it gets a little poo-pooed and it's not really fair at all, because the man was a phenomenal artist and draftsman. And what's really nice is all the books are being reprinted now, been reprinted for a while. You can get them back like they were before, back in the 50s or 60s. Great, great books. So Loomis is awesome. Oh, there's the Vanderpoel book.
Yes, yes, the gray one.
Yeah, exactly. That's drawing a human figure, right? Yeah. The Vanderpoel, excellent book. I mean, if I was an alien from another planet and I didn't know what a human being looks like, I read the Vanderpoel book and that will tell you exactly what the human being looks
like. Now, how do you like suggest digesting, for example, like Vanderpoel, you know?
Oh, yeah, yeah. So the book kind of is written in a little bit of old English, you know? It's a little, sometimes some of these books are a little bit hard to follow, but I never read the book cover to cover. You pick a part that interests you and really... take that in. And like, for example, if you get the Harold Speed book, read a chapter, you know. I would start it with dynamic symmetry. That, I tell you, you understand that, that'll change a drawing, you know. So and just pour over and digest that chapter. But I find that they're not like the kind of books that you want to read cover to cover. Let's see, now you're mentioning these books, give me another one. What's another one?
Like, I love the female morphology.
Oh my God, that's so a great book. And you know, I wish that I had the title of that book. You know, this would be something that we could maybe even do another
session
on, and I can have a pile of books and just show them to you. And I'd love to share them, because, you know, one of the things that we do getting in this craft is we become these eclectic book collectors, mm-hmm. right? And I tell you, of all my possessions, my books are my most precious.
Oh yeah.
And especially my art books. You know, they were said that one of the things that they found when Rembrandt had passed, one of his most cherished possessions were his prints of paintings. You know, back in the days they didn't have photograph, but they had artists that would create these copies, these lithographs.
Mm-hmm.
And that was his most cherished possession, right?
Wow.
And I think we all can connect with that. I mean, it's like, oh my God, you know, the house is burning. Got to get my art books. You know?
Hey, I agree.
Yeah, so anyway, I would love to give you more information. Please feel free to email us. You can email me at andrew@ameralart.com, and I'd be more than happy to give you a list of books that you can maybe begin to start your collection. You probably already have some of these. And, you know, and it's nothing that sure, it's something I may have acquired or collected over time, but
mm-hmm.
these are things that I'm learning from other artists, other students, other people that have shared with me. So I just like to keep that conversation going.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's very important, you know, to start on the right path. There's so much content out there.
Yes.
I love like just getting like a direction from someone.
Absolutely. And you know, our teacher, Sean Forster, has a wonderful collection of books on composition. And it could be really helpful. I think they would be really helpful for any painter. Because, you know, in the end, once you learn this method, right, what do you do with it? What are you going to make with it? So that's always the challenge for all of us. So to have at least a point of departure, an idea of how to go from taking what you're doing and actually making a painting, that's really important. And there's some more books that we can recommend to you on that as well.
Yeah, and it's like some books were written by, not necessarily, well, old masters too, right?
Yes,
like Solomon has his own book.
And, yeah, there you go. Solomon Solomon book is great.
You can't take a, you know, private class with him now, but
you can
read his book and you can see like how people study.
And you get this great point of view. I mean, there's a beginning part of Solomon Solomon that he basically rips on everything that we do in the studio. You know? And it's great because in the end, there are so many different ways to attack this problem. And reading these books give you this other perspective. But in the end, what I love about all those books is the goal is the same, is to develop, I believe, is to have that deep connection with nature, you know, visually, and to create something truly alive and beautiful.
Yeah, yeah. So I feel like we can go on.
Oh yeah, we can go on forever.
Needs another session, but.
Great questions, by the way. Thank you all so much for your interest, and thank you for emailing us these questions.
Thank you guys for all of the support. Thank you for these like really awesome questions, and talk soon.
Absolutely. Take care, everybody. Be happy, be safe.
Totally. Bye.
Bye-bye.